there. I think we're about ready to get started. I'm Molly Steenson. I think I know a lot of you here, but I'm an associate professor in the School of Design. And along with my colleague Austin Lee, we curate the lecture series. Once in a while, you get to hear someone speak, and you don't know anything about the person going in. And then you realize that afterwards, you see things very differently. And then you get to see that person sometimes speak more than once, and you become pretty convinced that she should come and speak here at Carnegie Mellon. When I first saw Sara Hendren speak, she talked about what she says are the unexpected places where disability is a part of design. And it was this framing that was just a shift in how I saw things, and it was fundamental. And so you'll hear more from her tonight. Sara is an artist, design researcher, and a professor at Olin College of Engineering, which is a very unique college of engineering in the Boston area. Her design and artwork is a part of the Museum of Modern Art's permanent collection. And at Olin, Sara teaches socially engaged design practices, adaptive and assistive design, and disability studies. And she is a longtime writer. Not only has she blogged at Abler and she has a really active Twitter stream, but she's at work on her first book. So I'd like to ask your help in welcoming Sara Hendren.
Thank you, Molly. It's so good to be here. I'm a big CMU fan from afar, but this is my first visit and I've had a really great day talking to a bunch of you. I want to start out talking about wonder and skepticism with a picture of Carl Sagan, who may be known to you. He was an American astronomer and astrophysicist, cosmologist, and more. His career was mainly in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s. He wrote hundreds of scientific papers and something like 20 books, but he's most known as a kind of, as a popularizer of science for general publics. And this is sometimes a dirty word for academics. So he had a mixed reputation, I think, among some academics because he was thought to be sort of maybe less than perfectly serious. Why? Because he is most known for Cosmos. Are any Cosmos fans here? One of the most watched series on public television in the history of PBS, communicating kind of the wonder of space. And so you get like the internet full of images like this and like this. Be cool like Carl. Because he had this kind of willful, I would say, curiosity and even cultivated naivete in the face of the wonder of the world. And I want to just read to you, I won't read a lot of slides tonight, but I do want to just read to you a particularly interesting quote, I think. Science involves a seemingly self-contradictory mix of attitudes. On the one hand, it requires an almost complete openness to all ideas, no matter how bizarre and weird they sound, a propensity, in other words, to wonder. But at the same time, science requires the most vigorous and uncompromising skepticism, because the vast majority of ideas are simply wrong, and the only way you can distinguish the right from the wrong, the wheat from the chaff, is by critical experiment and analysis. Too much openness, he says, and you accept every notion, idea, and hypothesis, which is tantamount to knowing nothing. Too much skepticism, essentially rejection of new ideas before they're adequately tested, and you're closed to the advance of science. And this quote ends, "A judicious mix is what we need." And maybe this seems self-evident to you, and I think I'm rather disappointed by the kind of denouement of this paragraph. A judicious mix? I mean, this is like a really paltry kind of end for what is an extremely difficult task. That is a disciplined mind that cannot just blend and compromise between an absolute gee whiz wonder and then an exacting analysis and skepticism, but the agility to sort of hop a fence between those two things and to cultivate such a habit of mind that does and can do both of those things with ease and with nimble kind of movement. That's the work of a lifetime. And my work is situated between the arts, which is the realm of wonder, historically speaking, crudely speaking, and skepticism, which is the realm of STEM, sciences and engineering. And I want to just make a strong argument tonight that it is a difficult task to employ both of those things. But for the thorniest kinds of social issues and futures, you powerfully need both those things, including Carl Sagan's kind of, again, kind of willful curiosity and even wonder that looks even like naivete. I'll say more about that. So I teach at Olin College. This is a screenshot from our website. Brand new. Do people know Olin here? More than normal, yeah. So we're about 13 years old. We're 50-50 men and women by policy. We have no departments. We have no tenure. It's a really interesting place to work. I could talk more about that later if you like. And I run this lab called the Adaptation and Ability Group. And we are in the business of investigating normal, the notion of normalcy, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Typically, when you think about a lab for creative technology in the body or disability and technology in an engineering context, you think of things like this. So the kind of next generation of prosthetic limbs, and these tend to be exclusively high tech. They tend to be mostly replacement parts, and they tend to embody a kind of return to a mimicry of the body and a return to normalcy that we think of as the highest form of engineering, surely. That is the restoration of function as we know it. And so you'll get things like this, images like this in the media, that are synonymous with, this is what we think of in terms of prosthetics. So restoring functionality in the biomimicry, the sort of the best money can buy, 14 grip patterns on a mechanical wrist, et cetera. But also I think the cue here that the wedding ring, the sort of sense of identity here is restored by these feats of engineering. Or the kind of comparison, this is a commercial comparing a woman on, again, these super high-tech legs to the power of a car, et cetera. That's the dominant notion. That is a heroic engineering that is rescuing broken bodies. All really interesting stuff, but pay attention to that kind of mythology. Whereas the situation is actually so much more interesting than that. If you look a little bit deeper, this is a cochlear implant. I'm showing you, I'm sure plenty of you are familiar with cochlear implants. A lot of R&D and engineering has gone to cochlear implants to restore some hearing to people who are deaf. An interesting kind of logic of therapy and cure for engineering. That is, again, restoration of a cultural notion of normalcy, biological normalcy. If you, however, go to Gallaudet University, which is an all-deaf campus, if you know Gallaudet, you'll find an architectural kind of design program there enacted called Deaf Space. It's some 100 points of design that's actually created to accommodate deafness. And so you'll see here the pods between these classes here have short walls because ASL is a visual language. You don't actually need to be cutting off noise, et cetera. Similarly, the corners are faceted at the meetings of hallways so that you see people before you run into them at a corner, again, to solve for kind of sonic cues that you'd be missing. So again, here, it's possible to be interested in this technology. Super interesting. Logic of therapy and cure, however, at work here. This is a logic of accommodation of difference. You find plenty of people at Gallaudet not at all interested in cochlear implants, not at all interested in hearing. And so this is a kind of forking path for young designers and engineers. Again, possible to be interested in both, but those choices are radically different. What is the young maker to do in the face of this? Same is true of autism. This is a kind of social robot, really common kind of prototyping that's being done with social robots for children on the autism spectrum. And the social robot here is meant to teach things like recognizing facial cues and body language and this kind of thing. Again, also a therapeutic sort of logic to this design. But if you look at Specialist Turn, this is the homepage of their IT firm. Specialist Turn is an IT firm that was started by a father of an autistic child who noticed that the cognitive profile of autism, not for everyone, but for plenty of people, is actually very well suited to IT work, to the skills that are required. So he created an IT firm that's staffed entirely with consultants on the autism spectrum, actually to accommodate for and to, in fact, use the profound skills of the autistic community to create a really robust model for business, not as a charity project, but as a kind of recognition of difference. Here again, logic of therapy, logic of accommodation. So systems design here that may have something to say to what we thought of as product design, medicalized product design. So I'm interested in this kind of technology, for sure. I work at an engineering school. but I'm interested more in a design, a flexible engineering and design that actually does some solving problems when they're presented by people and what they want and what they're asking for, and some that also can ask questions. And indeed, I'm interested in it in an entire making practice that can do both of those things and in fact refuses to separate those things, if possible. Wonder and skepticism at once in the investigation of normal. So I'll just show you a few projects that I've done in recent years. This is a man named Chris Inahoso. You can see he was born with one arm, and probably five or six prosthetic arms were built for Chris when he was a child, because here he was born this way, and his parents thought, well, the best thing surely for him would be to get a replacement limb. I mean, this is, again, it's the modern era, it's what engineering should do. But Chris, because his body is radically adaptive and plastic, as all bodies in all forms are, he could, you know, he's incredibly dexterous with his toes, and he was just like, he would take like two pieces of Legos and he would, you know, brace one against his shoulder and then click it together here. Like, he was just like, he was just far ahead of it, and he found those prosthetic limbs to just be dead weight. It just never worked for him. So he does the world one-handed. He's a microfluidics engineer. So I met him just randomly, and we stayed in touch just because we had plenty to talk about. And when I was looking for people to partner in this class, investigating normal, and in my lab, I said, you know, what about this? Would you ever come in? And he said, you know, I can think of a use case that would be interesting to me, and that is rock climbing, because it's something that I do find difficult. I'm not really interested in that universal myoelectric $80,000 arm, but I am interested in this. So could we do that? So a couple of teams of students worked with him, and I'll just show you a couple of the renderings. There were a couple of teams, one of whom worked on a kind of modular, super low-tech socket model that used compression technology, and they were really committed to kind of doing a fairly rough and ready, easily available materials, and another that did the prototyped an extension arm for rock climbing. And we were mostly interested in the modularity notion of an arm that could be a single-use arm. Again, not even attempting universality, but a kind of snap-on, snap-off limb. And this is the extension that he's actually found the most useful of all. He gets some atrophy in one of those shoulders, so he's able now to load the arm with that simple socket. This to us is just a really interesting way to reframe the problem, to invert the question, to ask again, what is the world assuming in that kind of high stakes, high innovation, high cost biomimicry, when there may be other kinds of questions that we could ask? So not this, right, but this. Second is a project with a woman named Amanda Kasha, who's there on the left. Amanda is a little person. She has a form of dwarfism. And she's a professional. She's an art historian and a curator, so she gives talks a lot like this. But you can imagine at her stature that this podium, which she would call a leggy podium, is standardized for somebody of typical height like me. So she had a designer in San Francisco worked with her to build a wood podium that would be at her scale. But she wrote to me soon after that and said, you know, I'm traveling a lot. What I actually need is a podium that could come with me. It needs to be collapsible and portable and really strong, but also hold, you know, the right area. But again, like, not too big in terms of the airplane and stuff. And this was just like a super irresistible set of design constraints. So she said, can we do this? And I said, yes. So she came to my class and we kind of prototyped in cardboard. And then students kind of really thought through, like, okay, what are the folding patterns? What's the kind of overall shape of the thing? How few moves can you do to kind of open it up and then collapse it again? And then they ended up building this first model out of carbon fiber, which I love for functional and aesthetic reasons, because you don't need to build a podium out of carbon fiber, but if you do, you are mixing that high-performance aerospace kind of material with a highly unlikely kind of application, which I love. So there it is, kind of in the three states of its being, with magnets to kind of be self-enclosing. And here's Amanda performing it, which becomes, by the way, a real-time performance for Amanda. So sometimes, you know, she'll go and whoever it is, like a Molly introduced, you know, somebody will introduce and say, and here's Amanda Kasha. And she will, in real time, unfold that podium, and the architecture of the room then will provisionally shrink by a third, you know, for that moment. There's a kind of flexible engineering there. And to me, this is a really interesting question for our moment that is about digital fabrication and mass customization. Why isn't it that Amanda couldn't plug her specs into an existing manufacturing stream and to bring a little bit more of the world to her? Why are we still making things only at 100,000 widgets at a time, et cetera. So then I heard from another designer who just said, I've never met Hugo, the man in this, but this is what's beautiful about working online and in public is that sometimes people write to you and go like, I'm just kind of interested, do you want to do anything together? And I said, well, Amanda is using this podium so much, it's getting some wear and tear around the edges. So then he made, out of HDPE, this high density polyethylene, this 2.0 version with standard hinges and stuff, and you can see how beautifully he took out a lot of the weight with those holes and cutouts. My work is so profoundly collaborative. This is just exactly how this stuff goes. So it's like students get to workshop it in class. The lab kind of takes it over after that to finish it off, and then maybe we hand it over to somebody with more training than we have in order to deliver a real object. So there's Amanda teaching a class with that podium. So let me just pause here and say that what I am trying to enact in a design practice is a kind of disability studies 101 notion that is still as profound today as it was when it was articulated some decades ago. And that is that we live in a time in which the medical logic of disability would say that disability, human difference, however much you want to call it, differently abled or any of that, but that the place where it resides is on the human corpus. So your legs don't work as they should to walk around, or your ears don't work in the way that's typical and so on, but that the disability lives on your body. And maybe in the enlightened version, that's okay and we're gonna try to make it all okay, but that it lives on your body. But the social model of disability would say, no, disability doesn't live with respect to what your legs do or don't do. Disability actually lives in the interaction between this stuff, all the built environment, and your body. It's in that interchange. That is where disability lies. And that is why everybody I know in the disability activist community will not say they are differently abled. They will say, no, I'm a disabled person. That is a political kind of identity. I'm a disabled person, not by my legs. I'm disabled by a world full of stairs. That's where the disability lies. And that's a profound notion that I think we cannot say enough. And we still have too little vocabulary for. So language for ability, in the actual things that we make, in the infrastructure, at architectural scale, at product scale. That's what I'm trying to kind of get at. A deep sense of wonder, a deep, deep sense of wonder at what all bodies are doing all the time. All the time, all the time. Not overcomer stories, not super athletic stories, not sort of the rejection of the body and the victory narrative that's being told to us, you know, in those images that I showed you at the beginning. Just variation as normalcy, full stop. That this is the human, and to be able to build a world for with an Amanda, with a Chris, that could be flexible and change, and to recognize difference as normative. That's what I'm interested in. I also have a project that's not a maker project, but more of a kind of design archive. That's this project, which is called Engineering at Home, and it centers on this woman here, Cindy, who's a suburban retiree in Wellesley, Massachusetts. Cindy had a heart attack at age 60 and was in a coma for a long time, adverse reaction to medication and stuff, such that when she woke up, she was a quadruple amputee. She lost both of her lower leg limbs, and you can see here essentially all the digits on both hands. So she's got some opposing motion, but no, very little grip and so on. And in the wake of her 5 years of recovery, she qualified. She was one of the people who qualified for this myoelectric arm, which again, I showed you at the beginning. It's the best money can buy. It was an extensive insurance process to qualify for it. And she was very grateful to get to become one of these people in this tiny stratum of people who qualify for it. But it turns out that this arm literally is collecting dust in the closet in Cindy's house. And I met Cindy when she came to a workshop at Olin, and she brought with her this absolutely enchanting suite of objects that is actually making her life possible. And they all cost like pennies by comparison. And she was the one who initiated a lot of these things. So Engineering at Home is a kind of archive that is also meant, it has a kind of manifesto about it, about where engineering lies, where we don't really expect it, and what is truly adaptive technology and assistive technology, and where are the unexpected places where we might find it. So we have focused on things like simple rubber tubing that allows her to put eyeliner on herself, Zip ties, beautiful ratchets, like elegant, simple machine technology that allows her to manage like a small zipper. Or this, which is my favorite thing by far. Cindy worked with a prosthetist, a kind of four-generation family shop prosthetists in Boston. They were the ones who qualified her, you know, did all the insurance paperwork and stuff for that high-tech arm. But she said, you know, what I really miss is writing like thank you notes and my handwriting. That's like, I had great handwriting and I loved it and I wanted to be able to do that. And can't you build me something? Once she started doing like the tubing and stuff, she was like, there's just got to be something for me. And so this shop, which is again run by this family, they were like, well, we got this like scrap of silicone. Let's just see what we can do. What if we made a cap that would fit over her hand? And we would have to, you know, calibrate and lodge that pen exactly right. But sure enough, they did. And it's her handwriting. That's astonishing. And what's interesting to me about this is that, like, does Cindy need to actually write anymore? She doesn't. I mean, like, speech to text is actually really good right now. But she wanted to. And this is, it's incalculable how cheap this thing is. But so then that gave birth to this whole set of objects for her to take in public to self-feed. And look at that. I mean, I'm just astonished every time. It's just sort of, so this is not meant to be a rejection of this technology. It's a both and kind of argument, but it is a, Cindy, I hardly need to say, is not the representative of the maker movement that we so laud in this culture, right? I mean, she is not that person, and yet she is a site also of invention and creativity, and the things that she wants to do live in places where I think we haven't really thought about before. So that's engineering at home. So all of these, and I've just told you a couple really quickly, I'll share a couple more in depth, but all of these projects proceed, I hope, from a disposition, again, of both wonder and skepticism. Skepticism about a predominantly STEM-driven, medically-driven notion of what constitutes disability and bodily normacy and measurements and metrics and so on. And again, a deep sense of wonder, a kind of willful curiosity about what it is that people do and don't do, how their bodies work, where adaptation and creativity and resilience are found without any of that cultural baggage about what we need to tell each other about disability, about it being something that you need to shed or overcome or victoriously manage, but instead that there are openings and closings with every bodily state and let's design for that world. So I'll just tell you a little bit more in depth about an ongoing sort of long-term project of mine called Slope Intercept. A little math joke for you. It's about the incline plane, which is a simple machine at Galileo's kind of classical configuration with the lever and the pulley and the screw and so on. Possibly how technologies like the pyramids were built. The incline plane alters behavior of force across a surface. So it is a silent kind of sleeping machine. I find this incredibly enchanting in an era of Arduino and apps and so on, that the machinic work that's being done just by the kind of incline of surfaces is also with us all the time. So this started as a suite kind of five ramps of that stack and that nest. They're about 3 foot square and they've got a big piano hinge on one end. And they've got these big casters so they can be moved around and so on. And they're designed for two kinds of city users that I think are never considered in the same headspace at all. I hardly need to say. We never think of skateboarding and wheelchair use. Why? Because we tell a story about skateboarding, which is seeking elevations in the built environment, with athletic virtuosity and a kind of transgressive action in the city. And we think of wheelchair use as a medically tragic use of the inclined plane. And I was interested in trying to see where the Venn diagram of these things could be kind of forced together. People who use wheeled mobile gear in the built environment, people who, again, are marginalized but for very different reasons. So a couple of things. Those ramps meet a gray area in the architectural code of the Americans with Disabilities Act in this country. So if you're building new architecture, of course, you have to create ramped entrances everywhere. But if you have a single step entrance like this, this is all over Boston where I live. I think it's all over Pittsburgh. I can tell by the age of this city, certainly all over New York, Toronto. you are grandfathered in. It's a super gray area what you're required to do if you have this little mom and pop shop, because it's thought to be onerous and expensive for you to overhaul your building, unless you are, you know, doing a new bathroom and all kinds of other things. Then you trigger that code and you've got to create a... So what this means is that there's a very complaint-driven dynamic whereby there are temporary ramps on the market, but they're hard to get, and they're it's idiosyncratic how it is that you reach them and so on. So I was trying to think about, like, what if you had a set of ramps that created a kind of, in a will among a community to create an inclusive built environment, and you could tell where they were and they were available to you. And what if in this story in my head, what if you, this person could use this for this chair and then could be used down the street for skateboarding, which in Cambridge where I live is technically illegal. It's tolerated but illegal. But could you mix those? Could this become a kind of story where those ramps could live? This is just, again, along Cambridge Street in Cambridge near where I live, so that the preponderance of that typology, that single step entrance. But I'm interested, you know, in the playfulness of the ramp here, and then also in its access. I mean, those ramps are over-engineered to take a heavy motorized chair with a full-grown person in them. They meet the specs for temporary ramp code. I mean, there's, you know, there's profound skepticism in the sort of engineered, load-bearing, kind of like exacting analysis there. And I hope they are meant to evoke a kind of wonder about who uses them and when and for what ends, who's playing in public, who's getting access, et cetera. But this project really came alive when it became a ramp to a kind of series of events. And this is in Toronto with a professional skateboarder and community developer on the right and a wheelchair user on the left. We went around Toronto in a workshop format and kind of took phone photos of various features of the built environment, the inclined plane and more, and remapped this kind of neighborhood in Toronto. And then I asked and invited a number of people to come and hold a forum. This person, Luke Anderson, who runs the Stopgap Project, wheelchair user, he runs the Stopgap Project in Toronto, which is also an activist ramp project. Ariel Stanyi, who is, again, a skateboarder and community development person. This person from Parks and Rec in Toronto and an architectural theorist. And I just thought, for me, what was interesting was having an hour where a skateboarder and a wheelchair user could tell the person, like the bureaucrat in the room, you know, like what it is that they would like to see in the future of the built environment in Toronto. What else could be possible? And could that weird Venn diagram work itself out? Could there be some overlaps and distinctions that people were excited about? And then more recently, I've been working with a wheelchair dancer named Alice Shepherd, who contacted me a little over a year ago and said, I heard you're a ramp kind of person, and I'm looking for, and she said, I'm looking for a ramp for dancing, a stage kind of ramp for dancing. And I have learned, I mean, the disposition of the designer, right, is like, I'll know enough to know when I get there. You know, so she said, you want to do this? And I said, yes, I do. I work with incredibly talented students. I think we could probably pull this off. So Alice came to campus and gave an artist talk, and we built this kind of provisional dance studio for her in a place where there's never dance going on, never ever. And we did a kind of audit of the built environment, sort of testing the performance of her wheelchair on various kinds of inclined planes. She went to the motion capture studio with biomechanics students. It was really interesting. And then between our dance tiles that a student club had, my little ramps you can see there in the foreground, and then some prototype-y ramps that students built, we built this kind of little playground for her to sort of figure out what was possible, what she could do. So I'll just show you like little 45 seconds of this. I just want to, just to call back that disability studies thing. Alice is not interested in overcoming her body, in performing athletic prowess. Like, she's not interested. She is interested in the wheelchair as expressive physics. 100% in making beautiful things in a different kind of body. And so she has no need here of a ramp, of saving by a ramp. She's interested in making an art form in this alternate platform, which is her body and its extended gear. And all of you, of course, have your extended gear, all your glasses and your phones and your various things. And this is another kind. But it was great fun. Yeah. So they got to this paper model, a couple of laser cut paper models, and ended up building not just the CAD, they built the whole 24-foot ramped stage. This is first year students, 18 years old. It was really hard. It was kind of like I had to drive them to the U-Haul to rent the truck because they're legally can't rent the truck. You know what I mean? Like they are really young. And but they into the night built this thing because they were just determined to do it. I mean, it's the superpower of engineers. They have bias to action. So they built this thing, and then Alice came back with her collaborator Laurel Lawson, and they prototyped dance on there. And then we handed it off to a professional stage shop, and they performed last weekend in New York. And but you'll see here the formal kind of fully vetted, professionalized shop here, and I'll just show you a tiny bit more. So yeah, that's kinetic light. So it's an ongoing, we just had no idea how this would really blossom. It's an ongoing, but don't you love that, especially that like pendulum swing at the beginning, that kind of just like, just that what's made possible by the sheer physics of the incline there. It's so beautiful to watch. But in the process of this, I had been invited to be part of a show in Seoul in South Korea last August, and Alice came last spring, and I was watching this whole prototyping platform thing, and I just thought, this is what we should do for that installation. So this yielded a second design, which is this ramped kind of platform kit that we're actively developing right now, and that we installed in Seoul. And Alice came for the opening and performed on it. We installed these ramp kits at two different sites, in Seoul, and we went for a week and ran programming. We invited a bunch of chair users in Seoul. I visited a bunch of disability activists there. We did a kind of audit there of the built environment, what exists in Seoul for Korean wheelchair using activists and so on. And then of course it was beautiful to see the wheeled users, that's bikes late at night after hours at one of the sites, and the youngest wheeled gear riders. Too, just again, making play. So this is a kind of Jeremy Deller, you know, famously said, I went from making things to making things happen. And I am really interested in design work that becomes eventual work. So stuff that happens in material form that is the provocation for exchanges, for new conditions, for relationships, for unlikely bedfellows, all those kinds of things is what I'm interested in. Solving problems, yes, and asking questions. Wonder and skepticism. That's kind of the function of the lab. I often house my work between these kinds of axes. The one on the left, which is of course the turf of engineering, that is function, practical use for instrumentalist ends. I mean, that, again, that's a crude notion of engineering, but it is the pole of engineering. And on the right, friction, what's performative, poetics and uncertainty, that the realm of art can, in other words, a body of work slide along these axes where some leans heavily on the engineering end and some leans heavily on the art end, and is there some, and of course, I suppose design is in the middle here, but can one insist that a thorny, complex cultural and biological issue such as disability, that it begs, in fact, for all those things? And that no one approach would suffice. Okay, so finally, I'll just tell you about this project, the Accessible Icon Project, which began with this symbol, with the international symbol of access. I was blogging for a long time, more actively than I am now, but about prosthetics and assistive technology, and I noticed the difference between this top image, that one you'll see everywhere, and then the one on the bottom. Just the differences in the sheer design integrity. the kind of organic form of this kind of thing. I started collecting these. This was in Marshalls and Cambridge, Mass, where I live. And I just thought, like, gosh, you know, the body is so central here compared to that other one, right? Like, look at the rounded limbs on this thing, and a chair is finally in motion, and like, there's so many profound politics tied up with the introduction of the International Symbol of Access. I mean, its provisions are absolutely historic. And so why wouldn't you represent people first? It's just like a basic isotype kind of integrity thing. And then I started looking at like 2D icons all over the built environment and noticing it's quite remarkable how with two colors, you can gesture and render these very active kind of bodily motions. You can walk up to this and you can know without any other text that you can ski and swim and so on, rapid exit and so on. And then I discovered this treasure trove, which I recommend to you, which is the Flickr set called Stick Figures in Peril, which is like, it just keeps on giving, like all the stuff that, like you couldn't have dreamed, like all the things that can happen to you. And I started to think, like, well, if this is such a dynamic representation of the body in all these ways, and like, why not this symbol, which again has all the virtues about it of standardization? I can go tomorrow to an airport in a place that I don't know, and I can find where the bathrooms are and where the assistance is. And I mean, it says, of course, not everybody with disability uses a wheelchair, but that's the virtue again of standardized isotypes, that they stand for something everywhere, irrespective of culture and language and so on. So I was working with a philosopher graffiti artist, not a lot of those around, but this, I was collaborating with him on another project at the time, and he loves defacing public property. So he was saying, why don't we run some experiments? Like, we could probably do this. We could use spray paint, or like, we could, you know, come up with a new symbol. And I fought really hard for this. We ended up at this after those experiments, because I found that if I held up those two images, one next to the other, did people actually make the connection and go, oh yeah, there is a difference. So we had this clear backed sticker that we placed on top of the old one. And of course, because this is technically illegal, we got some media attention about this project as illegal defacing of public property, which is a super boring issue, but that's what people like to write about. So then we said, yeah, that's true. It is, I suppose it is technically illegal. Can we talk to you now about the politics of disability in public space and talk to our self-advocates who are our partners, who identify as disabled, and ask them what they want, which is like an accessible built environment and accessible education and transportation and, you know, all those things. So eventually we were asked to come up with a real symbol if people wanted to replace an old symbol with a formal new one. So we worked with a graphic designer named Tim Ferguson Souter, who brought it in line with kind of all the features that you expect from pictograms in the built environment. And we put it in the public domain, so it's free for anyone's use. And now it's been picked up by people everywhere. Also, this man in the blue shirt runs Triangle Incorporated in Malden, Mass, and he really was the one that took this project to its eventual state. He said, why don't you come and we'll change over we have like a day when some fancy lawyers come to our job development center for adults with disabilities. Why don't you come and join us, and instead of doing the volunteer day that the lawyers usually do, which involves like cleaning the basement or whatever, why don't we change over the signs at our site? And then we'll have a conversation about disability and all the kind of awkward stuff that people never want to talk about. And so that became the kind of catalyst for a whole series of events whereby young people, especially with disabilities, go and paint signs when they're asked to do so, when people need them. And also, this is Brendan Hildreth, who doesn't use a chair but does use a speech, text-to-speech voice machine, who's become kind of the regional director in North Carolina. And then, like, it started appearing in places that we'd never imagined, like this doctor in Delhi, India, who wrote to me and said, I used your symbol in front of my hospital, and I'm agitating in my, you know, municipality for disability rights, and we've just stayed in touch over the years. But it was just like, he hardly needed to say anything else, because it was just like, I know exactly what you're doing. Your context is completely different from mine, but like, I see you out there. You know, it was like a little node. The graphic could be a little node by which people found each other. So it lives on social media. It's in like super official places, and then places that I can't even, they have no context for at all. In fact, if somebody knows what's happening here, I would really love to know. And like in sort of making coalition politics like this. We've seen this everywhere. Wish we'd thought of that ourselves, to be honest. So it's in lots of places. You can download it for free in multiple kinds of formats. I mean, when I got this through Instagram, I felt like, okay, this project fully exited our authorship. Like, it's so far beyond us now in the best possible way. Like, it was a convivial object that people could use in their context completely for their own ends. We don't police it. We have no idea. And people don't even know that it's us behind that project anymore. Our names are often, just as often, not associated with it. I got this from my friends at the Women's March. Really happy about that. So again, that's the accessible icon project. So that project, that kind of public design project, I think lives in the same house with Chris's replacement, Chris's modular arm. For me, the hope is all those projects between function and friction, practical and performative, et cetera, can live together under the lab. So a judicious mix. Will never do. A judicious mix is far too paltry a term for what's necessary in the world, right? I mean, and there are so many disincentives to cultivating your wonder, not to your skepticism. That's everywhere. I'd say that's in plentiful supply. I'd say the wonder is harder. Genuine wonder, without sentimentality, without treacle, without patronizing. I mean, genuine, open-handed wonder at what bodies do, not what they can't do, what they can do, where they fall on the curves, but that we're alive in these bodies and that they do amazing things and they adapt every second, right, to a new built environment. So I'll just end with Susan Wendell. Not only do physically disabled people, I would say, disabled people of all kinds have experiences which are not available to the able-bodied. They're in a better position to transcend cultural mythologies about the body because they cannot do things the able-bodied feel they must do in order to be happy, normal, and sane. If disabled people were truly heard, an explosion of knowledge of the human body and psyche would take place. Thanks so much. I can tell you, if it matters to people, I can tell you I have an 11-year-old son who has Down syndrome. I have a number of family members on the autism spectrum. I do live these politics every day. If you have questions about this whole designing for and designing with and speaking inside or outside or speaking for on behalf of all that stuff, we can certainly talk about that thorny stuff. Yeah?
Could you speak a little bit about universal design?
I can. Yes, it is a key word, isn't it? And I think of it as an aspiration. You know, a lot of people don't know that the OXO Good Grips tools, you know, those kitchen tools, start. Do you all know that started with a woman with arthritis? It's a design school. You probably do know this. But that is a classic sort of, or lever doors as opposed to door knobs, like those kinds of universal design. The logic there, of course, as you know, is you take an extreme user case and you find clues in that for a generalizable and barrier-free architecture and so on. And I am, of course, celebrating all those amazing new feats of architecture that create that barrier-free world. Spalding Rehab Hospital is a brilliant example in Boston where I live, where you just wave to open a door to the bathroom and like amazing stuff like that. I think my work lives in a slightly messier place, which is like what I often call the edited city. You know, like what are the cities that we've inherited, and then how do we intervene in those places to try to point to, I suppose, a world of universal design. But also, I'm most excited about waking up the inherited structures of the world and showing that they're malleable and accidental and arbitrary. You know what I mean? So I think universal design, again, is an aspiration, and it's something that I want more engineers to be conversant in. And I also want a kind of, a kind of engineering disposition that is like, how do we unwind from the stuff that we have rather than only dreaming new, you know, new futures. I think it's a both and kind of deal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have any recommendations for sighted designers when it comes to challenging your assumptions, both about what's easy for certain populations with disabilities and what's hard?
Yeah. So, like, when you're in a prototyping process or early in a research stream,
yeah,
and challenging those assumptions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ideal choice.
And I'm glad that you brought this up, because I want to say, with respect and humility, that the simulation exercise for disability is the kind of dominant paradigm, and it's really controversial in disability studies. Why? Because the logic there is, if you try on cataract glasses or whatever, that will generate a kind of empathy, and therefore you will see that not everything is easy for people, right? And then you will design better. That is logic, and it makes sense. It makes sense as a logic. But the data show that people walk away from those experiences going, two things: thank goodness I'm not disabled, and that's really hard. That's really hard, full stop. And that, to me, is the opposite of wonder, which is like, that's a different experience, right? It's got some challenges, it's got some features, it's got some assets. But we have such a monolithic notion that disability is a diminished form of normal, that an empathy experience actually doesn't accomplish its ends. So, to answer your question, I think you ask people, I mean, I just think there's no substitute for getting people in the room and asking questions. The Institute for Human-Centered Design in Boston is creating what they're calling a user expert lab, so that's like people available for consulting in corporations, in classrooms. And that's why I do the way I do in my classroom. I say to Amanda when she comes, like, look, my students need to be able to ask you, is it okay to say dwarfism? Like, how do we navigate this awkwardness, which I think is the key barrier to people asking people to come and try things out. They're just afraid of getting it wrong. They're afraid of offending people and saying the wrong thing. So there's no substitute for people in the room. And you want to find those people who you pay them for their time and you're respectful in all of those ways. Above reproach in terms of the ethics, and also declaring the classroom a place where, you know, and the early prototyping stage, a place where people can ask hard questions. We just don't know, right? There's no substitute, I think, for that. Yeah.
Fantastic, really, really. I just wondering on that last point, almost like going beyond just trying to achieve empathy, but are there situations where you've come across where, I guess, the experience of having a particular disability or being disabled in a particular way has given people experiences that others would actually really like to have?
Yeah.
Like, how's that? I mean, that sounds kind of creepy.
No.
Are there situations you've come across with that?
Yeah. Well, there is certainly true in history. I mean, this is a little bit of a universal design thing. Maybe it's not quite what you mean, but Alexander Graham Bell was married to and the son of two deaf women, right? So he was thinking a lot about the case of deafness and sound, so you know that story.
Yeah.
Well, so in other words, you can look at early telephony deeply tied up with deafness in a really interesting way. But are you asking something else, like a kind of pleasurable experience? I think Alice is in that business.
Yeah, exactly. That's what
I think Alice is absolutely in that. I mean, you look at that and you sort of, and I did have students sort of say, like, can I do that? And she was like, I don't think so. You know what I mean? I mean, and that is, I think, a lively conversation. Would it be consumptive for students to have that experience? But I do think that Alice enjoys, when you saw her doing that, demoing that for students, she was saying it's a sensory, pleasurable experience. And she was just like utterly inverting. That is what you mean, right?
Yeah. I think I'm just thinking of cases like sometimes with like the Paralympics, for example.
Yeah.
Who watch that and almost get to a state of saying, like, almost, I wish I could do that.
Yes.
I wish I was able to do that, regardless of whether it was whether I had to use a wheelchair or not.
Yeah.
I wish I could get to that level of skill with it that actually, you know, that itself could be an activity regardless of someone's...
Regardless, right.
Like, but the skill that's gone into it. I just wonder whether there are kind of...
I mean, I think there. When I say to you, I genuinely mean that everybody in every bodily state has openings and closings. I think that is what I mean, where I'll think of something, a particular anecdote, but I just, I don't know, I think about a little girl that I know who is blind and mostly deaf and has a lot of mobility, atypicalities, and I'm going to say this without any sentimentality, that she has a profound sensory experience of the wind on her face for hours at a time. And so, like, zero soft piano music here right now. It's just that she is having, you know what I mean? But she is having a deeply pleasurable experience in her body. And it's not tragic, you know? And it's, I think the difficulty is not interpreting it as such. So that's one, but we can talk more about that. Yeah.
I'm just wondering if you've done any work with sensory integration issues that are kind of on the spectrum, but...
Yeah. I did a project with body socks. Do you know what body socks are? So sensory integration issues is tied to sensory processing disorder, and all of us fall on various spectra in how we process. So you are privileging the sound of my voice right now and probably backgrounding the traffic out there, but sometimes we are dysregulated and all sound is coming at us like a wall, or we are undersensitive to cold or pain or something like this. And it often attends the autism spectrum, but it is a separate thing. So just by way of background. And so I did a thing with body socks, which are these Lycra envelopes that people can wear. A lot of kids in school settings wear them therapeutically because they invite you to push powerfully against them to have that like super tactile feedback, but they also give you an envelope for privacy. So I brought those into public space just to invite people who don't identify on that spectrum to like have that experience. I guess it's a little bit like this, to have that experience, that kind of... And I certainly see Wendy Jacob, who was an artist who was at MIT for a long time, worked with Temple Grandin. Do you know Temple Grandin? Yeah. Famous autistic self-advocate. And Temple Grandin, maybe you know, famously built a hugging machine for herself that she would crawl in at the end of the day. And Wendy Jacob, who's an artist, designed and built a series of chairs that give hugs. Like they reach up around you like this, and they're activated by like an air pump by another user. They're showed in gallery settings, but they're also practical objects. I mean, Wendy was like one of my biggest influences. So that's about sensory integration, right? About getting what we need in terms of like deep pressure by a proxy. And I've seen lots of other work actually in this realm. I think people are super interested in it. We started keeping weighted blankets in our library at Olin. It's really interesting. so practical, but also poetic stuff.
How would you recommend students get involved in public design and intervening to make cities more accessible?
You know, I think probably what you're learning here, collaborative design, participatory design practices, right? Like coming alongside, is that what you mean? Sort of a form of allyship? And
I suppose so, but I really appreciate like just going out and making changes, even though, like, of course, it is technically vandalism.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is there an easier way perhaps getting into public policy with design?
Yeah.
Because that could be long and, like,
yes.
Grueling.
Yes. Well, that's what people said to me. They were like, well, if you feel so strongly about it, like, why don't you just go down to City Hall and, like, tell them, you know what I mean? And I was kind of like, oh, you've never been on a committee before, you know? Like, in other words, I felt like that project depended on its being unignorable in public. But like, this is tremendously problematic territory because you have to exercise all kinds of ethics and whatever. Like, I had a lot of chair user friends before I started building ramps, you know, and I was, that single step thing came from a friend of mine who was talking about negotiating single steps and the politics of that. So yeah, it's like, it's one of those being an insider and an outsider, but I do think that there are plenty of disability rights organizations and schools and so on that would tell you about that stuff. I do think, but you're asking about the broader, like, how do you know when to just act, you know, and I think you can do relatively safely some small scale kinds of things. That grew from like a couple dozen little stickers to gradually kind of being, and we got a lot of pushback for it, to be honest. It's not easy, is the non-satisfying answer that I'm telling you right now, but it's true. Yep.
So a lot of all the projects that you showed here are kind of dealing with people who know how to respond to, they're at the point in their life where they know how to respond to a world that's maybe not built for them.
Mm.
Do you ever work with kids or younger people who maybe don't know how to talk about the way they are or how to negotiate that?
That's such a good question. I know a huge number now of atypical kids, partly because of my family situation and partly because of my work. I would only point you mostly to the Adaptive Design Association in New York that works with kids building and prototyping low-tech tools and furniture for kids, because they do it low-tech because then kids can, if they're nonverbal, they can, in whatever way they manifest, say that they're, that something's not working for them. In other words, it's a low-tech approach to kids because they're on the cusp of their development, always changing and so on. But I've learned so much from watching them and kind of interned with them and stuff. But that's the extent. And we did, one team of students in my class last fall worked at the local elementary school. This is kind of to your question, too. We just said, are there any tools that the PTs and the OTs and the therapists there working with kids, are there any tools that you want that you wish were on the market right now? They're too expensive, or it's like too provisional and you just want to prototype it? And students did that, working with one student. And that's this other way of getting around. Like, we were not pretending to be the medical experts, but we were there available to design and prototype stuff. But it's a super overlooked space, I can tell you that for sure. Partly because the assistive technology business is kind of a racket. I mean, it is. If you look at those, the catalogs and things, it's like thousands of dollars for things that may or may not be useful. So you need a lot of like provisionality and design edited environments, you know, precisely for kids, because they grow, their bodies grow, but also their capacities are just constantly plastic.
So that was called the Adaptive
Design Association. They're very findable, yeah.
AdaptiveDesign.org.
Yes, thank you. Yeah.
I was wondering what, like, how you felt about, like, kind of segregation in terms of accessibility. Like, for example, we have the Olympics and the Paralympics. Mm-hmm. And like, is that kind of perceived as like empowerment? Like, this is our own thing that we can own, or is it? More like, why do they have their own separate Olympics? Like,
why is it separate? Yeah. I don't have the inside knowledge enough to say with any broad sweep. I think people were celebrating this past time when the Paralympics ran that it was getting more like primetime TV coverage, which I think was new historically. And that, as far as I could tell, was greeted with a lot of excitement. Not because it was sort of like, we're gonna erase the para part, but more just like, it's sport, full stop, it's interesting. Can we get an audience for this? But the segregation issues around all this stuff is really interesting and thorny and very specific, right? Like, in other words, some people want the availability of separate schools for particular conditions and whatever, and others say no inclusion at all costs, and it's just more complicated. So, yeah. Yeah.
I love that you were talking about wonder, and I'm wondering if you have any advice for fostering wonder.
Yes. I've long been a hopelessly kind of earnest type, you may have noticed, and now that I'm in my 40s, I stopped apologizing for being kind of earnest. I don't know what to say except, like, you, if you look, well, I think this is like going to cross over into the Oprah segment of this talk, but like, I really do think that cultivating gratitude, that actually looking around the world and being willing to be surprised by it and being available to be moved by it, you know, I dare say that is a discipline and a virtue. And I see it in short supply. And why, I mean, it's not, wonder is not the opposite of like deep political engagement. Like, I'm the mother of a child whose prospects after graduation, and he's in the best possible inclusion situation in Massachusetts, and his prospects in terms of employment just plummet. I mean, like, I have urgency and skepticism is also right there at the fore. But I often say my ideal is like, I'm smiling, I'm baring teeth. Like, I'm smiling, I'm baring teeth. Like, I am smiling. I am at wonder in the world. Why? Because that's how I get the world that I want, you know? But it's wed to, and indeed, it's fueled by a deep sense of like, I wake up every day going like, is this important? Yeah, this is really important. So it's a both thing. Carry on. Don't be afraid to be earnest. Yes.
Moving off the question about segregation, I was wondering if you think about it, and then how you would think about the social aspect of this, and then the disabled people you work with, to people who aren't disabled are still at least currently seen as other.
Yeah.
And if you handle it as a form of oppression.
Yes, but sorry, so tell me the question, like...
Do you think about this, do you think about the social aspects of getting people who aren't think about other people?
Yes. As part of the practice?
Yeah. How do
definitely.
You,
and how do I?
How do you get people like us who don't experience that to think about?
Well, I wouldn't be so sure that the us in this room do not experience that, for one. I mean, I know what you're saying, but like, I just find any room like this has people in it with deep stakes in this topic of this many people. But I will say, yes, I have, it's funny, I'm writing a talk right now for a disability arts conference, and that's really like the inner circle of people talking to one another. And I'm titling it, like, public is plural, you know, that in other words, I think that there is no general public and no one public for the work. And I think my post, and this is why I think Sagan is like the unapologetic popularizer, and I think it's okay. Like, I think my post is to translate a lot of deep work in disability studies for an audience that isn't predisposed to care about it. So that's why skateboarding for me is like a bridge. Like, if I can get you interested in this thing and like, oh, that's kind of disarming, and now we're laughing, and it's kind of like, wow, I never thought about that, and your wonder is activated, will you be able to hear then that wallop of politics that's coming around the bend? Because it's big and it's bleak, you know? So it is, I am rhetorically all the time going like, how do I actually make a new audience for this thing? Why? Because after my son was born, I realized, I mean, all my disability rights sort of community speaking to one another, I'm deeply nourished by those people, and those are my people in a very particular way. And we are only mostly talking to each other. So like, how am I going to get the world that I want if I'm not speaking out here and out here and out here? So people have very strong feelings about what's okay and what's not, and like where it gets glib and whatever. And like, Alice doesn't like my skateboarding thing because she thinks that's performative and replicating a kind of athletic virtuosity, even though I say I'm not doing that. It's like, it's complicated. But I feel like my post is bridge builder outside of the normative. Yeah.
So, Huber, I remember watching Huber's TED talk, and he said technology is inadequate, and it's not, like, human.
Technology is
inadequate.
Inadequate.
Mm-hmm. and human beings can't be broken. And I think at the end of the day, what you're talking about is very similar to like Huber's approach.
Mm-hmm.
It's about disability. And I loved your Cindy's example of her using those low tech for her solution. But once the technology catches up, and if it's good as mm-hmm. like Huber's legs,
mm-hmm.
and if that's accessible to everyone in a really cheap way, I don't know when it's going to happen.
Okay,
would
yeah.
Would you embrace that type of approach, or like, why low tech?
Yeah. Thank you for that question. Yes, yes, yes. Okay, I do think Huber's work is great. I did, though, for a long time use his screenshot, his homepage from his lab, which said the end of disability along the bottom of it. And I actually don't think, for one thing, I think there is a tremendous amount of hand-waving about lots of those kinds of technologies. But would I welcome a world in which people who want to walk again do walk? Of course I would welcome that world. But when I say that the social model of disability is the one that's true, those interactions, disability partly stands for interdependence, the condition of interdependence, which I think is the fundamental state of the human. And I think a lot of people in technology for disability presume that mythical, hermetically sealed independence is the natural state of the human. And it's not. History shows us this. I think we are built to be interdependent. It's in this culture that we've vilified the kind of any notion of dependence. So in other words, I want a world that is interdependent. Do I want agency and mobility and independence when it's wanted? Yes. I also want it to be okay. People said to me when I did the ramps thing, why don't you just park the ramps on the chair? Like, it'd be done, you know? And I said, but no, I want an infrastructural world that actually makes space to be in states of need, right? And if you start looking at the use of ramps, it's like little kids learning to walk, older adults, you know, who's like are losing muscle mass. In other words, that stuff won't, I'll never hang my hat with technology for solving this absolutely, because I think it's a social kind of condition, not one that's fundamentally, technology is inadequate, I'll agree, but I think there's a lot of heroizing around the technology for this stuff. I think it's about mortality and frailty and our repulsion around those things. And I think we'd like to tell a kind of near future story about that's being solved by the tech. And I think it's a weirder future than that. You know, good tech, high tech, all yes, good, and also messed up social relations that we got to deal with. You know, so yeah, Ahmed.
I just had a question. As a teacher, and students will often come up with a whole set of assumptions, and I'm just wondering, like, your reflections on how you see your students' transformation within them as they work on these projects, and then how they sort of carry over, if they carry over this kind of, because we have all kinds of discussions around not just disability, but things like culture, race, other forms of difference, gender.
Yep.
And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about the experiences of your students.
Yeah. I mean, I often say that investigating normal is a critical theory seminar hiding under the guise of a design build studio, right? It is billed as gee whiz prosthetics, but it actually, the delivery of it is actually in a critical seminar kind of reading. Now, I teach all undergrads, so it's still pretty steep for them, that kind of on ramp, so to speak. But it is a smash together, half discussion, half, I mean, I have students building cardboard. One of the first exercises that I do, I got from the Adaptive Design Association. They recommended this to me. I had each of them build, each time, a cardboard fitting for something in their built environment that's not working for them, just to try to do, among other reflection exercises, to locate themselves on the human continuum, right? Not in a glib, like, we're all disabled kind of way, but just kind of like, stop, you know, like, get over the kind of heroic myth of saving people with this stuff and locate yourself on the continuum that is strengths and challenges and so on. And then there's just ample good media for talking and reading and so on for talking through this stuff. So we have to devote a lot of class time to this, but I do find that can be transformational for people. And there is no substitute for people working with someone like Alice, who just overturns all their expectations. I mean, the first time I had Chris with one arm in the room, like, there was a long pause when everybody in the room was going like, what is even the role for the engineer here? Like, they suddenly were not sure they were even necessary. And that was a beautiful, pregnant moment, you know? And I try to orchestrate those conditions as much as I can. And with people in the room, are my students surprised that blind people get graduate degrees? They don't want to think that they are surprised, but they are surprised, finally. They are. So then when people come into the classroom and demonstrate that they have subjectivity and relationships and all this stuff, that is doing that work for them. That is reorganizing the synapses in their heads for them. And they never, I think they don't forget that. I mean, I hope. That is my hope. Sorry, you were waiting. Do people need to go? Are we done with time? I don't want to be obnoxious.
We can take a couple more and give you a chance to rest.
Okay.
There are certain progressive ideas about social organization, like smashing the gender binary, that we think of like, oh my gosh, we're like, you know, we're broaching new ground with humanity, but actually there's really old traditions, places have already been doing this for a really long time. I was curious if there's any analogous traditions. The only one I'm aware of is in the deaf community.
Yeah.
But outside of that one that I've heard of, I'm familiar with, is there any analogous traditions of really different approaches to disability or different social appreciation of disability?
I mean, I feel like Oliver Sacks also taught us about an island where there were a lot of deaf people who all, and then the hearing people also learned enough sign so that they had a kind of very functioning community, and there was no need for... Not no need, but you know what I mean? It obviated the kind of like legal mandate model that we live with as a kind of, that's what you mean, right? Where there's a kind of natural adaptive social organization around difference and that this kind of thing.
Where the kinds of attitudes you're aiming for us all to adapt to the very deep level and a social level, how this has happened already?
I mean, yeah, right. Almost every culture in the world is better than the U.S., for instance, at accommodating aging. For instance, think about the status of older adults in most cultures of the world. I mean, it's really in this country that we decide that people become irrelevant and talk about segregation, you know. Whereas, in other words, historically the norm has been that an older adult with his or her diminishing capacities of various kinds is folded in naturally to the family at length and so on. In other words, that's a very old idea. That's not a new idea. So we're telling ourselves all the time in aging in place and stuff like, wow, what an idea. You know, like not shipping somebody off to a nursing home necessarily, but in fact that's an old idea. That's the go-to that comes to mind. And I think other cultures in general, where there's just a more collective, less transient and mobile culture, have figured out how to include people But I also want to say that the history of the world is also about a lot of stigma around disability in many cultures of the world too. A lot of hiding people away, and but there's no one way to. I mean, one can't speak in broad swaths about this. But you're certainly right that there are far older ideas that we are recovering, not inventing, for sure.
So I think we'll stop there.
Yeah, yeah.
I think we should give Sara a big round of applause.
Thank you.